And I'm gonna change the view to the speaker view so I can see myself. Oh, no, it's not working well. Better to work with the gallery. Anyway, so we are recording, and I'm going to go straight to the subject that we are going to be working with, which is grammar. So I'd like to ask you, if you'd like to participate, it's okay if you just come online, show yourself on the camera, and unmute your microphone so we have some ambient sound and that I can talk to you if you'd like to talk about anything or have any doubts, okay? Right now, so what I want is everyone to understand. So I'm going to switch to Portuguese just a little bit, okay? Just for a little bit, to talk about Português. Então, vamos falar da nossa língua materna, né? Português. Eu não lembro, eu não sei bem a experiência dos senhores, às vezes tem aluno que é bom nisso, mas eu tenho uma professora de português fictícia que eu chamo ela de Dona Gertrudes. Ela tentou me ensinar desde a sétima série até o final do terceiro ano do segundo grau análise sintática. Ela tentou, né? Era, todo ano era a mesma coisa, análise sintática, análise sintática, análise sintática, análise sintática. E a gente ali tendo que decorar uma coordenada adversativa, sintética e blá, 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 e tudo isso. O que me deixou um pouquinho chateado com gramática. Agora, eu já falei isso em inúmeros grupos e algumas pessoas falam que não, eles gostavam. Né? Que não, isso eu entendo, consegui aprender e sei até hoje, tem quem sabe. E, de fato, a gente sabe uma coisa ou outra, né? Mas não tudo. E nós conseguimos escrever sem saber, né? Isso é interessante. But what about in English? Can we actually be effective and write well in English without the knowledge of grammar, of English grammar? I was teaching, before this class, I was teaching a group of students and I mentioned this. I really do not believe at all that you can write well in English being not a native speaker. I believe that is mandatory, the knowledge of grammar, in my opinion, because we need to use this rationale to actually, it's a tool, it's an asset, it's a weapon we might have that the Americans don't always have. So not only we can write well in English, but we can become better than they are. That is interesting, isn't it? Because we actually can learn the grammar. So this course of legal writing will be very much grammar focused. I need you to know and understand the grammar of English. Well, many people have tried, not many have succeeded. What is the problem? You are intelligent folks. How come you do not know the English grammar by heart so far? If you are in this conference, you know that is the Institute of Legal English, and you know that the course of is of legal English writing. So writing in English is already difficult. Imagine drafting legal instruments and learning. That is a little bit complicated, isn't it? Well, I'm going to give you some good news now. The grammar of English is not complicated at all. It is simple. And that is the reason why English has become the second language of the world. Oh, no, because it's because the United States and the United Kingdom are everywhere. That counts. But if the Germans were everywhere, we wouldn't be speaking German. It's too difficult. Have you, any of you tried? I have. I have lived in Frankfurt. I study 5 hours per day. No good. Trying to learn German was trying to catch a fly with a chopstick, like very difficult. I saw in the Karate Kid movie that Senhor Miyagi was not able to. It's really difficult to learn German. I try, I can communicate, but then you try to write, try to learn the grammar. It's going to be lots of years, many years trying. So the point is that English is not complicated because the grammar is easy. But why don't we know it if it's so easy? Well, I took teacher's training to become an English teacher in many of our franchises. So we are going to talk about the grammar of English. So why is it so easy and we do not know it? Why is it so easy and we do not know it? That is a good question. Why is the English grammar so easy and we do not know it? First, the English teachers normally they don't know it too. They haven't studied the theory, the core theory, the secret. This is not marketing, okay? The secret that I'm about to review, that is going to change your life forever. But not this is not marketing. But well, that is true. There is a problem in the system that did not allow us from Brazil to learn grammar. Actually, I have taken teachers training in when I was in my early 20s in those franchises, and that they tell the teachers not to teach grammar in class. So that is easy. You cannot teach grammar, so you don't need to learn it. That's nice. First point, yes. Why? For which reason? The reason is that students normally do not want to learn. And if you push the grammar to the students here in Brazil, they might be willing to leave the course. If they don't, they leave the course, they don't pay. If they don't pay, the school goes bankrupt. Not good idea. But the problem is that those students, they lack of purpose, many, and many others, they want, but they don't find sufficient good information. Another problem that we have is that we have mixed Portuguese with English. And I believe that's the main problem. The first problem relates to the fact that we don't get the information at all. But the second problem is that when we actually get the information is incorrect. Is inaccurate because we have mixed Portuguese with English. For example, can you give me an example of what is gerúndio em português? O que que é gerúndio? Alguém pode me dizer? O que seria o gerúndio no português?
Vou estar enviando sua mercadoria.
Vou estar enviando sua mercadoria, né? Então, o
e nós
gerúndio.
falamos em inglês do presente contínuo, indica uma ação que você está executando aquela ação naquele momento.
Isso.
Está falando dela. Por exemplo, eu estou falando nesse exato momento. Seria o gerúndio.
And
Só
what
que
about...
eles usam. Só que eles usam. Eu vou estar enviando. E não, eu, no caso, como presente contínuo, eu estou enviando. Eu estou falando agora.
Yes, but let's think about the English language now. The concept of gerund, of the gerund, is only to have the ing of the verb. For example, playing, playing, that is a word in the gerund. Gerund, that's the gerund of the word, because the gerund is different from the present continuous then. For example, the gerund can be the infinitive in English. For example, loving is the best choice. That is an example where we have the use of the gerund, but in the infinitive. You see, English has different concepts. And the main point is that we gotta remember that they are very two different languages with different origins. And those different origins will give birth to a very different theory of grammar. O português, ele trabalha com verbos. Nós usamos um idioma com tempos verbais. Então, são tempos verbais o tempo todo, né? É, temos aqui... Eu havia dito à minha mãe que não era uma boa ideia ela fazer tal coisa. É, eu enviarei o cliente um sample do produto. É, eu estive... Então, o verbo ele vai se modificando, né? Quantos tempos verbais nós temos? Acho que 15, 16. Uma coisa assim bem extensa, né? Uns nem são muito utilizados. Por exemplo, ele dissera, eu falara, alguma coisa assim. Eu não lembro exatamente nem qual tempo verbal é esse. Mas o português, ele trabalha com tempos verbais. A conjugação do verbo, ela nos diz muito sobre a ação em si, né? Inclusive, diz quem é o sujeito. No inglês, a conjugação do verbo não diz quem é o sujeito. Então, você tem que repetir o sujeito o tempo todo. I spoke with my mother about that thing and I had to deliver something to somebody else and then you need to repeat the subject because the verb is not going to tell you who is the subject. O verbo não diz quem é o sujeito. You see, but the main difference in theory is not only that we don't conjugate the verb much in English, but the fact that English is not a language based on tenses, just like Portuguese is. English verbs can show only two tenses, the present and the past. That's it. So let me circle this. English verbs can show only two tenses, the present and the past tense. If it's shown only the present and the past, and we have two tenses, try to compare with Portuguese, how many tenses we have in Portuguese. Eu acho que são uns 15 no português. While in English, we have only two. So we have already a gigantic difference in meaning. So that is the core of the theory of the English language, the topic of tonight's class. The fact that we have in English two tenses and in Portuguese we have so many. So how can we just translate without thinking? It's impossible to bring the information to a verb from a language to the other like that. Many people are able to read texts in English and understand a great part of it. Because actually English is about 50% derived from the Latin. Na formação do inglês, você tem 50% de latim, é muito. Vem grego, latim, é francês, because England used to be an empire with France. England used to be of the Roman Empire, and we have lots of connection the English language has lots of connection with Latin, we much more than German. So we might think that it's pure Anglo-Saxon, but it's actually divided. It's half Latin and half Anglo-Saxon. And because of this, a person with knowledge, especially scientific knowledge, can read a text and understand. You have been to many classes of English throughout your life to be here in this group. And maybe a few of you might have some problems speaking English, might find it difficult. And I see among very intelligent people this difficulty of speaking English. They actually can understand, they can travel to Miami, they can go somewhere, but when it's time for them to speak, they get insecure. And that is the problem. Some people are just like parrots. They repeat everything they hear, right? They hear, so they repeat. They hear, so they repeat. That becomes easy for them to communicate. But some people are not like that, especially among scientists. They don't like to speak when they don't know. So they are getting insecure. And because they are insecure, they don't speak. And they became insecure because of this difference. They cannot just get the sentence from Portuguese and send it to the English language easily because of a core difference in theory. English verbs show only two tenses, the present and the past. We use about 15 tenses, so how can we translate? That's an interesting question. So how can we actually speak in this sense? Okay, let's learn more about the English language and try to get some answers. I brought the problems already, as usual. Okay. Well, there are three aspects in the English language, and they are the simple, the progressive, also called continuous, and the perfect. Three aspects in the English language. The aspect is the perspective of the agent related to the fact in time. The aspect is the perspective of the agent related to the fact in time. Let's connect those dots here, trying to understand a little more. Yes. So, what is an aspect? It's what lacks of meaning when we have the verb, because the English verb doesn't show much. We have then the aspect that will give you lots of information. And if you actually know the aspect, you may be able to understand English itself. We cannot make a connection and a literal translation. Then we need to understand what is included there in each aspect to actually be able to use it. One of the greatest mistakes of students is to shift from an aspect to another without proper motive. If you are using the present simple, there must be a reason for you to be using the simple. If you are using the progressive and the continuous, there must be a reason for you to be using the continuous. And if you are using the perfect, there must be another reason for you to be using the perfect. So that is the core of the English language, the English grammar, this understanding that you need to understand the aspects, all of them. But they're just three, come on. It's not that difficult to understand. Let me change something here. I'm trying to. Olav, are you online? No, let me see.
I'm here.
Oh yeah, there you go. Nice to see you, mate.
I just listened to you.
Yes, that is nice. Okay. So talking about this knowledge of the aspect, do the Americans use the present perfect regularly, just like any other tense? You that lived so long in the United States. For example, I have just been to my friend's house. I have already worked with that.
I have been.
Have you worked? Have you done the things you're supposed to do? For example, is it common for them to be speaking using the present perfect in the United States?
Yeah, it's common, but they normally abbreviate the "I have been." No, I've been to my place, to my friend's house. I've worked with something, and it is common.
Yeah, that is nice. The point is, if you are, they do it naturally. But well, we have many students here, even though they are not on the camera. That happens to me when I host events. The point is, if you want to participate, students, you would be very welcomed. I could talk to you and we could have a great time. But coming back to the point, do we actually, as English speakers of English, do we know how to use the present perfect, for example? Any of you, do you have any familiarity with the present perfect? Do you use it when you speak English? Just like a Native American or somebody from the United Kingdom?
I think that the perfect aspect is the more difficult for Brazilian learners to comprehend.
To understand.
Understand.
Thiago.
Yes.
Can I make a quick observation? One thing that's very important is that, at least in the US and I believe in the UK, is that you don't use the passive voice, you know. I grabbed the book, not the book was grabbed by me, you know. I've been to some place, not the place was visited by me. You know, the thing is, you always active voice, always voice ativa, jamais voice passiva. In English.
Yeah, they English do use the active voice all the time.
Never passive voice.
Yes. And but an interesting point is that we actually do not know and we don't use a third of the English language that is the perfect. We have three aspects, as I just told you. And what is the simple? Okay, even the name is simple. The simple aspect, that's something you can learn. The other would be the continuous aspect and the progressive aspect. That is a little bit different from, I'm gonna show you an example how things can be a little bit tricky. I'm gonna save and clear this whiteboard and I'm gonna give you a quick example here. Okay. I will go to Japan next year. I am traveling to Japan next year. All right. Oh, maybe let's take off the go and use travel anyway. I'll travel to Japan next year and I'm traveling to Japan next year. Both sentences are in the present tense. We use a verb in the present. It's a modal verb that leads the action to the future, but it's the present tense. The past of will is would. Well, Now that we have two sentences saying the same thing, I might ask you, which one, in which sentence you know that you are going to Japan next year? Of course, that could be a pandemic with the coronavirus, but apart from that, in which sentence you actually know that you're going to Japan?
On the second sentence.
On the second sentence, Pedro.
I think so.
You are totally right. And why?
At least from what I remember from English classes, will is generally an expectation of something that can happen, but the going to sentences or the continuous sentences are always something affirmative that is definitely going to happen.
Yes, because of the main characteristic of the progressive action is that the progressive is something that is going on, that has movement. I like to draw it just a little. There is an arrow I like to draw that is about the action in the continuous aspect. It has started in a point in time. That is the main characteristic. And eventually it will end. There'll be an end, but it has already started. How come if you're only going to Japan next year? Well, you might have called Mr. Yakamoto about a meeting. You might have already purchased the tickets, the airplane tickets. So you did something because this action is already in progress. That is the idea, that the action is in progress. So it's going on, it's happening. Very nice. So you see, something quite silly, but with lots of meaning. Because we are moving from the simple to the progressive here. That is the point. We are going to move from the simple to the progressive. So it alters the meaning. Why did you shift tenses? That must be a question you are supposed to ask. Thiago, why is this is so important for writing? Because if it's a problem when you are speaking, imagine when you are writing a contract, for instance, a complaint. This course is very good for people that, for example, want to work in the United States. Let me give you the heads up. Our money in Brazil is worth nothing anymore. Yes, maybe thinking about the international market has become a good idea. For example, if you have a base salary in Brazil of 20,000 reais, right now you would be making in the United States $3,500 as a salary. That is not living like a rich person in the United States. That's a low salary. I believe New York is not an option now anymore. You better go to the country. Well, we are comparing the money of a great salary in Brazil, 20 grand. That's good money, right? Per month. So one of the targets of this group and of this class is to become good in writing in English. If you are able to write well in English, you may be able to work maybe for international companies or for international clients, or maybe send some publications or take courses abroad, master's degrees or doctorate degrees or any other type of course you might be interested. And writing is a key. So we really have to know how to write well. And the first step is knowing the grammar. And well, as I just told you, the grammar is not that big. Most of you are lawyers. My contacts are all lawyers. That is good, that is a problem. When I have a problem, I have lots of friends. That's good. But that is also a problem because you don't reach the entire market. You get very much focused on the legal world. But anyway, you want to write well in English. For that, you need the grammar and you know the law. If you know the law, you're specialized in an area of the law. For instance, Viviane, are you online?
Yes.
I'd love to hear from you. You're my colleague. Viviane teaches in Florianópolis, English.
Yes, I live in Floripa.
Yeah, that is nice. She used to live nearby my house when I used to live in Florianópolis. I used to live in a neighborhood. She used to live in the next neighborhood. Viviane, tell me, can you write well without knowing the meaning, the grammar in English? Do your students, by the way, do they have difficulties when they need to write in English? Do they like doing so or are they afraid?
When the school say we don't use grammar when we are teaching, when we are explain, I think it's a lie because we use grammar all the time. Example, a simple example, when you say a beautiful woman, an intelligent boy, we use, we have to explain that the adjective in English, it comes before the noun, the subject. And we use grammar a lot, all the time. So it's very important to say it and not in a different way. Maybe in a friendly way. I think it's better. Brazilian students have a problem when you say grammar, I think. It's my opinion. I'm not sure.
All right. That's great. For example, Maria, are you specialized in any area of the law, Marisabel?
Yeah, I have some areas that I more close to, like tax legal.
Tax law. Okay, Maria is specialized on tax law. That is something difficult to specialize in, especially in Brazil. Olavo, are you specialized in any area of the law?
I do specialize in constitutional law and international law.
That's nice. Okay. So learning the grammar. If we tell Viviane, for instance, to our students that the English grammar is way easier than the Portuguese, that will make them a little bit excited, I believe. Look, for law students, they have to learn so many subjects. Administrative law, they have to learn constitutional law, tax law, civil procedure, criminal law, so many areas. Well, we have to learn only three areas of English. We need to master the simple, the progressive, and the perfect. The perfect, Thiago, really, is that all you need to know? Not exactly, but that's the most important thing you need to know. And from my experience, I have been teaching English since I was 20 and 38 right now, so 18 years. From my experience, most of the students, they don't know those three aspects well. Especially the perfect. Actually, they know the simple and not really a lot of the continuous, and especially the applications we might have, and the applications of the past continuous, for instance. That's a very interesting thing to talk about. And but they really don't know much of the present perfect. They only build the constructions like, have you ever been to London? Or have you ever been to Rome? They know how to do that. Have you ever killed a person? Okay, that is something a learner from Brazil might know, but not all the rest. And because they don't know those three aspects really well, they didn't stop to get the proper information about them. they find a lot of trouble to reproduce their thoughts in English. Their thoughts that they have in Portuguese, the ideas that they have in Portuguese to English. For example, by using the present perfect, you might state something that has just happened. You can talk about something that happened in the past and has a connection with the present moment. And the most important one, the court ruling. Uma sentença. Sentença é o quê? Um ato no passado que tem efeito hoje, né? O ato finito acabou ali. Né? Houve um julgamento. E logo, por isso, efeitos ocorrem hoje. Mas não é uma ação contínua, uma ação única ali que tem efeito hoje. Então, the judge has held. The judge has held or has ruled, has held that. For instance, let's talk about a recent case. No, has held that this violent husband should not be approached. His wife has held that he might not have the right of visitation on his children. Let's talk about a new case. Olavo, talk about a new case in Brazil, something new about our law.
Recent?
Yeah, a recent holding.
The case now that during the COVID crisis gave more power to the states.
Oh, yes, that's a very important one, yes. The Supreme Court in Brazil has held that, has ruled that the states are free and the governors and the states' legislatures, they have the power to actually take their own measures against the coronavirus. And that's, they have jurisdictional powers in this sense, and they have powers to enact legislation, to actually issue documents and decrees and everything. So this was completely new from the Brazilian Supreme Court and has effects today. So now, today, right now, I'm here in Bombinhas. It's an island in Santa Catarina, almost an island. It's a peninsula. And the mayor of Bombinhas may issue a decree that has no connection with the federal government and we might have to follow. And the Supreme Court in Brazil has held that this is lawful. This is in accordance with the law. This is a use connection with the present moment of the present perfect. Another use is actions that are continuous up to now. They started in the past and they continue into the present moment, for instance. Another use of the present perfect is to give emphasis to a point. You use it just because you want to emphasize a point, not for any other reason. I have killed that person, for instance, something of impact. Experience, all your professional experience, all your personal experience. For example, I have taken courses in the UK. That was a very interesting experience I have to show. I do not say that when, because I'm not talking, I'm not telling you a story. I'm talking to you about my personal experience. I have written, just like I said in the beginning of the lecture, that when I was introducing myself, I wasn't recording this part, that I have published a few books and courses. I have published, because it's my professional and personal experience. So there are many applications. So it's important to know them all. It's a little hard, Thiago, yes, but civil procedure is also difficult, but we need to learn. So the advantage of English compared with the law is that we need to learn only three subjects. And the law, they are like 20, 30, 40. We were, before this class, we were studying the General Data Protection Law of the European Union, another subject to study. And this one will have a direct application in our speaking, and especially in our writing. in our abilities of writing. There is a software I like to use. Let me see if I have it here. No, I don't have it in this computer. It's in the other computer. But the selection of tenses, it selects the tense for you that you're using in a text. I am sharing my website yet. Let me stop sharing. Just a second. There you go. Okay. What else do we have in the English grammar that we need to know to write well? Let me share the right board. There you go. We need to know, well, we have here, once again, the English grammar. We know that we need to, it's the aspect simple, continuous, and perfect. All right. And in the midst of all of this, we might have some other topics of grammar, active and passive voices. We might have the reported and direct speech. So reported speech is the difficult point, the reported speech. This is the one that gives more trouble to the students when they take international exams. Because there is a rule of the reported speech in English that tells you that you must put the verb in the past, send it to the past when you report. And the reporting verb either this is difficult for the students of exams like TOEFL, TOEIC, etc. The reported speech modality, the famous modal verbs, what else? Prepositions. Come on. You all love prepositions in English, don't you? Anyone that loves preposition or hates prepositions? Do you find them difficult? In, on, at, onto, under, during? Complex prepositions like the lack of, in the course of, terms of, and others we have. So many prepositions with so many meanings to so much meaning to memorize. This is a characteristic of English, having lots of prepositions in our sentences. So we must study prepositions as well. What else do we need to know in the English grammar? Any hints, people? Anything that is necessary that you might remember? Topics of grammar? Voices, reported
speech. I'm not sure if it counts as a topic of grammar, but it's also important to know irregular verbs in the past tense.
Yeah, that would be the sounds maybe, right? Although the list of irregular verbs.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes, the regular verbs. You know that the hard ones for the students are the regular verbs. That's another problem of English teaching in Brazil. Most of the students and many of the teachers, they don't know how to pronounce correctly the regular verb, the sound of the end of the ed. They will normally pronounce the e all the time. So, for example, washed, they will say wash it instead of washed. There was another word we saw the other day, determined, or something. They will be pronouncing what they don't have to pronounce, and they'll make this mistake all the time. So phonetics, but that's not as important for writing as it should be. Other topics of English grammar could be numbers,
adverbs,
that's nice, adjectives, adverbs, numbers, and well, it's not a long list, right? types of sentences, simple, compound, complex. We are going to learn that in English. Subordinate clause, main clause, que é ação principal e subordinada, né? Oração, principal e subordinada. Eu sou muito bom em português. yes, a few topics, but you see, they are very similar to Portuguese. Don't we have active and passive voice in Portuguese? Yes. Reported speech, direct speech, yes. Modality, no, but prepositions, irregular verbs, conjugation, we have something much worse than irregular verbs in Portuguese, that's conjugation. But you see that the other topics, they are similar, which really makes a gigantic difference between Portuguese. There's the connectors as well, connectors. Like discourse markers or adjuncts as well, and others there. For instance, we would have nevertheless, although, notwithstanding, and all in all, and indeed, and so many connectors we might have. And the markers as well, they are short connectors. So there are some topics of English grammar that they are important for the students, those topics. And I believe that we must learn them all, but they are very similar to Portuguese. So the main difference in terms of grammar between English and Portuguese will be the three aspects and the fact that you have only two tenses. So if we start from there, we can build a language, in my opinion. I'm gonna open for questions for 5 minutes. Any questions you might have about the grammar and writing? Any of the ones that are in the call? All right. So I'm gonna be moving forward to talk about the course, okay? So we are going to be working during this course on our writing. And the methodology that I'm going to be applying is that I'm going to give a lecture every week. And in this lecture, I'm going to be talking about the topic of the English language or of legal writing, And we talked about grammar and some characteristics of the English grammar that will make a contrast to our Portuguese. And that, in my opinion, is the reason why many have so much difficulty of speaking. But we are going to be talking about topics very much related to writing. For instance, any of you have the knowledge of what is a thesis statement? The famous American thesis statement. What is that? This is like people that write in English must know.
Is it the same as a tese in Portuguese?
Yeah, tese is an open noun. A thesis statement is more, the definition is more specific. More specific, for instance.
Yeah, I mean, a thesis is in the final work that you do on a doctor course.
A doctorate degree, yes. Yeah. No, it's not. It's a statement, only a statement.
Okay.
The thesis statement. Do you have any familiarity with that, Olavo?
Yeah. I mean, when you have a thesis, you have the main objective of the thesis, right?
And yes.
That's what's the point we're trying to make.
Michani, for instance, are you online, Michi? I don't know, Michi might not be online right now, but I'm gonna be asking you, a thesis statement is only one sentence. main characteristics of a thesis statement, it must say, state an opinion, a fact. For example,
main idea.
The main idea, that is nice. It's the main idea of the text. But it's a statement. It's only one sentence. And in most of, almost all English texts, they must come first. They must be the first thing that you have in a text. This thesis statement. And you see, in Portuguese, when we write lots of things before we disclose the main idea. In English, for them, it makes no sense. You really need to disclose your main idea in the beginning. That is the thesis statement. And it must be an idea that can be counter-argued. Que possa ser contra-argumentada. That is the point of a thesis statement. We are going to see how to build that, how to build a paragraph, how to write a text, a dissertation, how do they think about the text. And by understanding their culture of writing and reading, they will be able, then you shall be able to start to write in English. And if you do not use their style, they won't understand you. There is a big problem. So let's talk about the most important features of this course of legal writing here. In this website, I talk about it. So the points and the types of texts we are going to be analyzing, contractual clauses, academic texts, we are going to be drafting letters, emails. We are also going to be working with free writing. That's what I like the most. Complaints, briefs. Brief is a type of document, a legal document. Memorandums, it's an internal and external document in every American and British law firm. It's very nice. The types, the style of legal reasoning, the way they think about the law, which is different from our way of thinking, how they reason. And they have techniques for that, for reasoning that we don't use much. So this is basically what we are going to be learning throughout 5 months of courses. And there is a table of contents here. That is a file I'm going to be sharing with you guys as well, so you can analyze. In this table of contents here that I have drawn, you're going to see that the first month is basically focused on English grammar. And in every class, I'm going to ask you to write something. And you need to be delivering this project to me every week. And I'm going to be reviewing your text and giving you a feedback, a weekly feedback on your writing. The purpose is to make you, to get you able to actually work in English, to be able to write in English. So the first month is basically the construction of English. We need to know how to write in English. We're not talking about legal English in the first month, basically. Then we are going to be working with legal writing, finally getting some documents, storytelling. You need to know that to talk about the facts of a case, to talk about something that happened, IREC type of legal reasoning, memos, persuasive writing and characteristics of persuasive writing. In December, we are going to be talking about legal English itself, some terminology, poetry, free writing, and reports. I have students, many students, that they work in multinationals. The thing that they do the most is write reports all the time to the headquarters in other countries, especially the United States. So for example, I have a student of mine that work at Volvo in Curitiba. He's all day long writing reports. So that's a very important document. Well, generally, basically contracts, work of a lawyer, drafting contracts, contractual clauses, letter of intent, understanding this text, the style of contracts, how they are formed, etc. And then we are going to be talking about essay writing, design. So it's more linked with the academic world this last month for February. So if you wanna, it's more scientific type of writing. So this is going to be the main focus of this last month. People, first, I'd like to thank you all for coming and listening to me. I hope you had a good time and I could give you some knowledge you can take with you after this class. My students from the group that came to class, thank you for much so much for coming to the first class. I'm gonna be sending you the video of this meeting right after I finish. And next week, only the students will be participating. And we might have some more active productivity during the class, so you can participate more. It's a smaller group. It has been a pleasure. Thank you so much. And rest well. Have a fantastic night. If you have any questions, let me know. You can write directly to me. And I'm going to give you some more information on the group, okay? Thank you so much. Have a fantastic night.
Thanks for this opportunity.
Thank you, Thiago.
Night, Professor.
Bye-bye.